Hello everyone. So today we are here with Sanya Darakshan Kishwar, who is an assistant lecturer at the Jindal Global Law School. And we're here to discuss underrepresentation of women in the field of arbitration. So before we begin, before I hand over the mic to Sanya, I'd just like to tell you what are we going to discuss today and from where is Sanya coming from, what is her qualification and the various, honorable positions that she's held, in the past. So she's done her BSc LLB honors from Central University of South Bihar in Gaya. She has two LLMs, one in general law from Pennsylvania State University from the USA, and another in international human rights law from University of Leeds from UK. She's also been an oralist in the PSU team that won the 2019 William C. Wiss International Commercial Arbitration Court in Vienna. And also, she's been a research assistant under Professor Catherine Rogers on the project Arbitrator Intelligence. And now she's working as an assistant lecturer in the Jindal University of Law here in India itself. So today we will be discussing, as you all know, underrepresentation of women in the field of arbitration. What will we be discussing? I'll just take you through that before I, hand over the mic to Sanya. So we will be discussing introduction and nature of arbitration and the entire ADR mechanism, how women can be an asset in the arbitration field, statistics from different arbitrations showing underrepresentation of women, challenges that women face, and why women deal with underrepresentation in the field of arbitration, and the entire procedure of arbitration, and exactly at what stage or stages do women face gender biasness. So I think I will hand over the mic to Sanya without any further ado. So thank you, Sanya, for joining us today, and over to you.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction, and thank you for giving me this opportunity and platform to put forth my views on a topic that we need to discuss more and more, because we know with the rise in not just crimes against women, but the persistence in the continuation of gender biases against women, there are some topics that need more attention, specifically for women who want to go ahead in the career, and a career specifically in the field of arbitration. So before going further into any talks or the lecture, I would like to just share my screen with a small PPT that I have prepared to show some statistics which show underrepresentation of women and why this is a concern after all in the situation that we are in today. So if you could please confirm the screen is visible.
Yes.
Thank you so much. So the topic that I have chosen today for our talk is underrepresentation of women in the field of arbitration. And the reason why I have chosen this, and we'll see through the statistics that I will present here, and you can see in the slide as well, the statistics itself show that there is a concern of lesser women being involved in the field of not just arbitration, but alternate dispute resolution mechanisms as a whole. Now, before going into this problem or giving out a statement of problem related to the topic that I have chosen, I would like to give a very brief introduction to what ADR is and why we should, and what is the specific area that we are talking about. So alternate dispute resolution, as you all must be knowing, it's something which is different from the traditional litigation system of resolving disputes between parties. Now, this can come in various ways. This can come as a means of arbitration, mediation, conciliation, negotiation, all of which in the Indian context we have written down in the Arbitration and Conciliation Act 1996, if we talk about it in the Indian context. Now, it's not just the Indian context that has a reflection of less representation of women, but it's a problem that's being faced overall not just in the Indian context, but in the international scenario as well. So this is something which is not just of concern for us as Indians, but it is something which concerns people in the field of arbitration across the globe. Now, what is the specific area that I'm talking about? So I'm talking, when I say that there is an underrepresentation of women in the international field of arbitration, I'm specifically talking here about the field of international commercial arbitration. Now, by saying this, I do not mean to say that there is huge representation of women in other forms of alternate dispute resolution mechanisms, but my talk today is going to be focused on this one area of ADR, that's international commercial arbitration. Now, what's so specific and what's so special about ICA that makes us come here today, get gathered and talk about this situation? Why are we actually concerned about women being represented more and more, or alternatively, women being represented equally as men are represented in this specific field of ICA? Now, as the name suggests, international commercial arbitration has something to do with arbitration, of course, but it's international in nature, which means the parties that are involved, there might be companies who are involved in sales of goods, and they have to be situated in different countries, which makes the nature of the dispute international. Now, as we have the word commercial, so this means that it includes mandatorily something in the nature of commerce, that is sale of goods. Right, so not going into the technicalities of the area that we are focusing on, because I'm just giving an introduction for the sake of making us understand what is the scenario that we are going to talk about. So let's just focus upon the nature. So this is something related to commerce, corporate, companies, arbitration, right? Things like things which include business mindset, etc., etc. Now, without being biased, just have this thought in your minds, everyone who is attending, including me. What picture comes into our mind for the first time when we hear the word international commercial arbitration, or when we hear the word business? Men, right? Why is it so? Because we have that notion of a suited, booted, prim, proper man sitting on a table with his files and speaking with his clients, who again, in our mind, we'll have a picture of them being men as well. But why don't we just stop our trail of thoughts and think, why actually don't we get this picture of women representing big companies? Why don't we have this first thought of women as clients in a commercial dispute? Why don't we have this thought of women as representatives of companies, as a manager of company, as CEO of companies, right? Does this have to do something with the load that women can take up, or the efficiency of women? Right, these are some of the questions that we are going to see, and we'll walk our way through some statistics. So where does the problem lie? Now, as I have told you that I'm going to focus my talk on the underrepresentation of women specifically in this area of international commercial arbitration, let's just have a look at the numbers to see how grim the situation is. Now, Lucy Greenwood, she notes in one of her articles that only 6.5% of all commercial arbitrator appointments are of women. Now, we see women are not just underrepresented in the managerial roles, but when it comes to hearing disputes involving commerce at international level, when it comes to arbitration as a means of resolution, even there, women are not being appointed as arbitrators. And not just this, we can see other numbers. Harton also notes the same, that 6.5, this percentage of women, has to do with investment disputes or another ancillary type of arbitration, but not commercial. But yes, it involves investment disputes, which is kind of much like commercial arbitration, but then again of the same nature, business involving companies, right? So even there, arbitrators, the representation of women as arbitrators is very less, 6.5. I mean, these figures are old, 2010, but then in the next slides, we'll see some more recent figures of how many women arbitrators have been appointed. So this is just to give you an outlook of, yes, there is a problem. Now that we know that there is a problem of underrepresentation of women, we need to see more recent data. Now, as you all might be knowing, there are different institutions which take up the task of facilitating arbitration. Now we know this, the whole nature of arbitration is that there is an arbitration agreement between the parties. And most of the times, if it's not an ad hoc arbitration, if it's an institutional arbitration, then the parties note down in the arbitration agreement, agree together that they will be governed by such and such institution for the resolution of their dispute, if it at all arises. For example, if the parties choose LCIA as the governing institution for resolution of their dispute, then the parties, if the dispute arises, then the parties will go to this institution and it will facilitate the appointment of arbitrators on the behalf of the parties. Now, arbitration works in this way that generally we see typically that there is a tribunal which consists of three arbitrators, one being the president. It works this way. There are two parties. Each party will choose one arbitrator, and these both arbitrators will choose a common arbitrator who will be called the president, who will lead the tribunal. This is a general setup. Again, there are exceptions. We do have tribunals which have just one arbitrator or maybe two arbitrators, but the general scenario that we have is that there are three arbitrators in which two arbitrators are chosen by each party. Fine. So now, and all of this backdrop has to do a lot with the reasons of underrepresentation of women, which we will see. But let's just put a hold over that and look at what's going on in these institutions. Right. So now we know that there are institutions governing the facilitation of arbitration between parties. So we have these posh institutions like LCIA, ICC, VIAC, HKIC, the Hong Kong International Arbitration Center. And by this, we can have a look at what's going on in Asia as well. And now we have ICDR, SIAC, right? So many posh institutions, out of which the statistics which is presented before you shows some statistics from some of these top institutions. Let's see what's just going on. 2018 and 2019. Do the figures seem to convince us? I mean, 23% women, and in 2019, 29% of women. Just 6% hike in the representation of women on the arbitration tribunal. ICC, the figures are even worse. Now we see HKIC, the South Asian context, even worse. SIAC, everything. Like, we can't even see 50% of representation of women as arbitrators. Right. Now, as we have already seen, that we have this, kind of bias in our mind when we are even thinking about the whole area of economics, commerce, business, that, okay, we have men suited and booted, and we just can't get over the idea. It just doesn't stop there. The problem even goes on to dispute resolution mechanisms, and we don't even see enough women arbitrators being represented. Now, this is the problem. Now, what are the reasons for this? Now, as I told you, that there are lesser representation of women, not just in the field of arbitration, but even before that, right? In the leadership, there is a leadership issue as well. So we don't generally see women being appointed either as president of a tribunal or managerial position, CEO of companies. So we have those underrepresentation over there. Apart from that, even at a lower level, we do see that there is an issue of sustainable participation of women in arbitration. Now, questions like, do younger women who are trying to find
a career in the field of international arbitration, feel flexible enough to be in this field. Right. So, as you know, this whole notion of women being caretakers of their families women being the gender who has to carry both the family pressure of the family as well as the career alongside. The problem of sustainable participation here arises as a question before women. So they start to ask themselves, would we find sufficient opportunities? Would we find flexible opportunities for ourselves? Would we be able to sustain in this field of arbitration with our families? Right? Would the environment be flexible, etc., etc., etc.? So this is a problem that women do face, not just at the leadership level, but also at the entrance level. So some women even do not think of entering the field of international commercial arbitration because they know that there might be a problem that they might face when they'll be going ahead in their career, where they might face this problem when they'll be having families. Right. So these are some of the problems, some of the questions that might be considered as a reason for the said underrepresentation of women. Now, there's also some kind of bias going on across the arena of international commercial arbitration. It's just not about the appointment bias, but it's also because of confidentiality. However, I'll come towards the point of confidentiality a bit later, and I'll be discussing appointment bias first. Now, as I told you, as I started the talk with asking ourselves the question, what do we think about when we hear the word business, company, right? Suited, booted men. So there is an image that clients want to be reflected in the arbitrators that they appoint as well. So they want someone to talk like them, someone who will sympathize with them, who will empathize with them, who will know their situation well. Now, as we know that there is underrepresentation of women in the leadership roles, so obviously, if there will be a commercial dispute, of course, in an international level, there will be an involvement of biggies, big companies. So we can't even think of women being CEOs or women being the clients over there. So the people who will represent the companies will automatically be men most of the time. Now, there's the first place where we have to tackle underrepresentation of women. Nevertheless, now that we know that they mostly will be men, they'll want someone in the arbitration tribunal to be appointed from their side who will be in their own image, who will be like them, who will talk like them, who will be convinced by what they say. Now, of course, generally, it's not a gender bias, to be honest, but it's just something that people have in the back of their mind. Men tend to think that if we appoint male arbitrators, they will be easy to talk out with and they'll be easy to persuade. So their chances of winning or having one arbitrator on their side will be secure. So what parties think of while they are giving names for appointment of arbitrators is that, I'll appoint this arbitrator, then this arbitrator will suggest some name along with the other party's arbitrator to be presented as a president for someone, or like they will nominate a president. And, maybe if I'll appoint this arbitrator, if I will appoint a male arbitrator, he and the person who is appointed as an arbitrator from the other party, they together will appoint another male arbitrator, and, there will be all men sitting on the tribunal, and it will be easy to communicate with them, to persuade them, and they'll know that we are all men in this one room and we are talking about the same thing and we actually know what we are talking about. And that actually is something which Goldhaber says, this field of arbitration is pale, male and stale, right? So we can't even think of women being in the room along with all the men, sharing the same chair, sharing the equal room, or even if not, then the scenario of having a female arbitrator and a male client is something that's less of people tend to incline less towards that just because they want someone to reflect their thinking on the tribunal as well. So this is one another factor that leads to an underrepresentation of women. And where does it start? Where does this start with? This starts with underrepresentation of women in leadership roles, in managerial roles, in the companies itself. So that's where it starts. Now, another thing that all of you who have a background in arbitration, in international commercial arbitration, you must be knowing this, this confidentiality agreement, excuse me, that parties enter into. Now, it's rare that the decisions of the tribunals are published. Some of the institutions do publish the decisions, a few of its decisions. But, you know, because of this confidentiality thing, confidentiality agreement, we rarely come to know about all the arbitrators who are giving the decisions, and we barely come to know what is the quality of each arbitrator. Now, we do have websites and institutional websites as well that that list the name of arbitrators with their CV, with their previous experiences of being appointed as arbitrators, but then we cannot know about the quality of the decisions that they gave because of this confidentiality issue. Now, even though we have arbitrators, all the previous experiences listed in the websites, the one problem that arises here is that women do not get chance of being reappointed. The reason being confidentiality. Because the client do not know that this excellent decision that was given by so-and-so tribunal included a woman arbitrator as well, they don't even think of being inclined towards that woman arbitrator. This confidentiality issue, it has restricted the client from knowing the quantities, the qualities of the arbitrators. So how does it end? So it ends into a scenario where we have the male arbitrators who are really famous, or we can say the known quantities who are really famous, who have been reappointed again and again and again, because they were a part of a very hyped or very famous arbitration dispute that they resolved, and they got this big opportunity, and then they are being reappointed again and again and again, and their CV reflects 50 or 60 appointments. As opposed to that, women arbitrators, even though they might have been a part of tribunal which gave an excellent decision, but that institution did not publish the decision, and thus she doesn't get the chance of being known all across the globe that, okay, so this arbitrator, this lady arbitrator gave an excellent decision and she has all the right to be reappointed, right? So again, a small factor over here is also that male arbitrators generally do not tend to, give names of their female colleagues as a nomination, and they tend to be more inclusive in including their male colleagues. So that's a part of the problem as well, and that has to do something with not just confidentiality but also with appointment bias and many other factors, the internal politics as well. However, there is also, as I talked earlier when I was starting the talk as well, that it's not just in the leadership role, it's not just that women are less represented in the leadership roles or in the managerial roles, but it also has to do with the problem that starts way earlier, which I talked about, the sustainability of women in this field, right? So the sustainability issue, whether or not this area will be flexible enough for me, it all starts not just at the entry level, but also right at the stage when women are choosing the subject in which they have to go ahead, in which they have to specialize. Now, we don't have direct evidences, but Ms. Greenwood wrote a really good article over in her works, and she exclaimed that 65% of graduate trainees in the United Kingdom, they are women, but then only 11% of partners in the top 10 international arbitration teams are women. So we see, although we had 65% of graduate trainees, only 11% of them end up becoming partners of international arbitration teams. Now we are losing numbers over here. So where are we losing this? We are losing women through a leaky pipeline, quote, leaky pipeline, between the entry-level positions and the leadership positions. So this leaky pipeline is through which we are losing women. And the reasons for this leaky pipeline is not just restricted to women not going ahead with their careers because of their families, but it also has to do with other factors like sexual harassment or this whole, a scenario of insecurities going inside the head of women as to whether I would be able to sustain myself in this field headed by men. Right. Now, some of the factors, as I already said, it leads to reduced sustainable participation of women. Also due to, not just due to the factor of them thinking whether it will or whether or not it will be flexible when I have a family. But yes, we have to agree that problems of, carrying family and work together is something that bothers women the most. Now, the problem with the international commercial arbitration and other such fields is that it demands a lot of work. It has challenging schedules and it's just not that flexible. So, because we have so many men who are ready to work for 15 hours, we automatically expect women to do the same. And if women cannot do the same because of their personal commitments, family commitments, then we tend to, reduce the intake of women or reduce the appointment of women as arbitrators, right? So this, however, does not just apply to women with families, but it also should technically apply to men with families, and it does, but not to such a great extent. And this has to do with the setup of mind that we have, that we have this notion, this idea, this orthodox idea of women being the one who has to take care of a family. And if she is taking care of her work as well, so this is a dual burden that she's placing on herself, and she has to take care of how she will balance these both. And many of the times women cannot, and specifically after maternity, during maternity, she cannot, and they tend to drop off their career and sit at home, become caretakers, or alternatively take a more flexible option. Now, in the Indian context, this problem is even worse. And why I say worse, because when I talked about this orthodox notion of women being considered as a caretaker, women being considered as someone who has to take the burden of family as well as career. On the other hand, men are considered to be the bread earner of their family. In the Indian context, this gets even more complex, because remember I talked about this entry-level position and the leadership an arbitration position and the leaky pipeline being between these two positions. But in the Indian context, it gets even worse, because it starts even before the entry level positions. How? We know, we all know, even we have faced it in our personal lives as well, that lesser women tend to complete their education. Now, if we are talking about representation of women in arbitration, and if we want Indian women to be represented on that platform, we have to think about the many challenges that we'll have to tackle before we even reach to this entry level position. Those start with how will we fund our daughter's education? Now, we know that studies which are in the field of not just law, but also business, commerce, etc., these are very expensive courses, and women are generally pushed towards completing their studies in the fields of arts, etc., or maybe them being encouraged to take a more relaxed role, a more flexible career. So the problem starts here. When a woman has to decide as a girl as to what a field she should take to specialize in. Now she has these options of softer areas, more flexible careers, and she has this option of following her ambition of getting a career in this field of international commercial arbitration, a field which is dominated by men. Not just Indian women. Now at this point, not just Indian women, but women at large. We'll also face some questions as to whether or not she will be safe in that place which is dominated by men. Here comes the other factors that every woman has to take into consideration. That's regarding the safety that she feels in the field that she is choosing as a career. Now she has fears of being sexually harassed. She has fears of being bullied by her male counterparts. Now, many a times, if a woman is not able to, take up the task of being appointed as an arbitrator, and she turns down that invitation because of some, maybe she has to take care of her sick baby, or maybe she has an appointment with her doctor with her baby, or any other thing, then she's called incompetent. On the other hand, if a man does the same, then the response from the other side is, okay, we do understand. We'll want you in some other arbitration dispute in the future, right? So this is one bias that's across the globe. But in the Indian context, this gets even worse. Now, why? Because here it's not just about the field that women get to choose, but the problem that comes over here is also regarding the early age in India in which the women are preferred to get married. Now, we know that across the globe, this problem of a family steps in as a factor contributing as a catalyst in the leaky pipeline. But in India, it steps even earlier. At a very early stage. Now, even before women could decide as to what, whether or not they want to choose arbitration as a field, as a field of their career, they are married off. Now, when they are married off, they barely can even complete their studies. Just forget even thinking about arbitration, a field like arbitration. Additionally, if a woman chooses to go out in the field of arbitration and work along with men, we all know in the Indian context, she'll be taunted a lot, right? So these are some of the things that we might want to think about if we want to relate this topic that I'm discussing about in the Indian context. But nevertheless, I'll make it a bit more general and, go ahead with the steps that have been taken. Let's just try to think and talk something positive. Do we have some steps that have been taken across the globe for ensuring equal representation of women? So yes, we do. We have this pledge called Equal Representation in Arbitration Pledge that was taken way back in 2016. And it started as an idea proposed by a director general of LCIA in a conference. And then this idea was taken further by one of her colleagues. And then there were many dinners and many discussions, and the parties over there, they decided that a concrete step in this way ahead would be taking a pledge. And if the big companies and the representatives of the field of arbitration will take a pledge in this regard, then this will encourage more smaller parties to go ahead with the same same pledge as well, and this will encourage the smaller participants as well. So by far we have 4,000 participants, and things do seem to go in the right direction, but is it very right? Is it as right as we want it to be? Now let's just take a step back and look at the statistics. Now, the pledge was taken in the year 2016. We are in the year 2019. And the maximum that we see as a representation of women is 36.5% in 2019. That too by SIAC. Now, there are many other institutions which do not even report the statistical depiction of women arbitrators, and now we don't even know what is the scenario across the globe at large. So this whole idea of having this equal representation pledge, and then we have the global campaign on gender equality, we have other such resolutions, Alliance for Equality in Dispute Resolution, the AADR Inclusion Network Pledge, many other, including the Arbitral Women, the group that went ahead to sign a hard copy of the pledge, the Equal Representation in Arbitration Pledge, at an event that was organized by UNESCO itself. We have all these things, and you know, particularly I also have had the chance of working with Professor Catherine Rogers, who works a lot in this field of equal representation of women in the field of international commercial arbitration. And during our research also, we were very disturbed by the figures that we had at hand, you know, lesser women being represented in the field of arbitration, not just in the managerial roles, but on the arbitration seat, as an arbitrator. Now, we went through, I actually went through a lot of international commercial arbitration awards, and some of them which were available to us, of course, because of the notion of, because of this confidentiality agreement. So some of the arbitration awards that I had a chance to go through had all the arbitrators as male arbitrators, and I barely found someone who was a female arbitrator, just maybe one or maybe two in like 50 or 40 arbitral awards that I went through. Now, you see how grim the situation is. And when we speak of this steps being taken for equal representation, we should not just talk about taking a pledge, signing a pledge, et cetera, et cetera. We need to talk about it in the practical aspect as well. Now, we have certain companies who took this initiative of circulating a direction to their employees, as well as people who might send their CVs or request for appointment as in some roles in those companies. They gave out a notification across the board on their website that any letter that's being addressed, any email that's being addressed to them, should not include only sir. Like, the salutation should include both sir, madam, right? So there's a question of why all the big companies are not taking this initiative, right? Even when we write an email, we tend to, firsthand start with dear sir, good afternoon, sir. Why don't we talk about the madams? Right. So this is a problem that's so inherent in the whole context, not just in the field of international commercial arbitration, but across all the fields. Now we talk about equal pay, equal work, equal pay, things about that. We are still struggling for that. It's not just a thing that's related to this particular field of international commercial arbitration, but it's something that's also very inherent in the mindset that we have. Not just men, but even as women, we have this this mindset that that makes us think about the fields of arbitration, commerce, economics, et cetera, being something that's dominated by men. We tend to normalize this domination of men in the field of commerce, arbitration, business, and other such fields, right? So it starts from our homes, to be honest. It starts from us. It starts not just from men, but it also starts from us. We tend to give up our goals for the sake of taking care of our families, and the moment we do that, we are actually adding towards the underrepresentation of women. So it's better said than done. I know even I went ahead with the field of human rights rather than going ahead in the field of international commercial arbitration, despite me having a research in this field when I was at Penn State. The reasons being that, you know, again, the sustainability issue. Would I be able to sustain myself with the hectic workload along with the family pressure that I'll be getting when I'll get married and when I'll be having kids, et cetera, et cetera. So yes, this problem does, bother us at all stages. And I would like to share a story that comes into my mind here. So a woman who had applied for the post of being auditioned for playing an instrument that was generally played by men. And she applied at some 11 or 12 places. She got just one invitation. And in that invitation as well, the letter that was sent to her, it addressed her as Mr. So one bias there. And then she even went there and with all the men behind the screen, she played that instrument and people were so mesmerized that she finally got selected. And when she came out, people saw, the judges saw, oh my God, she's a woman. And how could you just play so well? We thought it's an instrument that only men could play. Then the reply that she gave is that it's just a bias in your head that made you think that I cannot. If I had played the same instrument without that screen that hid my identity, you would have not selected me, right? So just our identity of being women makes people think that, okay, she'll not be competent. Okay, she's just refusing to join that arbitral dispute and that invitation that we gave to her because she's a woman. Now, if a man does the same thing, the people say, okay, he must be having some, personal commitments. Let's just give him another chance. Now, why don't we get that another chance? Why are we considered incompetent when we want to take care of our families and keep a work-life balance? Why are men considered to be competent, even though we generally know that it's us women who have to take care of both families as well as the career? Why can't men as well do the same thing? Right. So we have this notion of maternity leave as well as paternity leave, but we see that there is a decline in the number of women who rejoin the career as in the field of international commercial arbitration after their maternity leave, while the number is okay with men joining after a paternity leave. Why? Where do we lose these women? Right. So this notion of flexibility in the field of arbitration and the field of commerce and the field of business at large, it's something that has to be tackled. I'm not proposing any solution how to tackle. I'm here to just talk about the many issues that women face and, this underrepresentation of women, not just in the field of international commercial arbitration, which I talked about today, but just other fields at large. See, if I talk about myself, and as I told you, I chose the field of human rights specifically because I felt that I wouldn't be able to stand up there with men and keep up with the workload and, keep up with the pressure that we have. There are many other women who do this because of this issue of sustainability, right? So that's something that we might think about. We might have another brainstorming sessions about this. We might invite women to give their views, women arbitrators as well. So I had this opportunity of working with Professor Rogers. We used to talk about ethics in the field of commercial arbitration. And now, when we were talking about ethics, we were also talking about this notion of impartiality that every arbitrator should have. Now, generally, as I told about that clients want someone on the tribunal who can represent them, who can talk like them. So generally, this also plays a role in the biasness against women. Now, they tend to think that, okay, she's a woman, she might not be impartial. partial, and you know, then we'll have a partial arbitrator, and we'll lose our chance of winning. So why not just appoint a male arbitrator? These things also you know, play a part. So we have this intersectionality of underrepresentation of women as an issue of gender justice and an issue of ethics in commercial arbitration as well. So we need to talk more about this, and we need to look about the more intersectionalities. For example, underrepresentation of certain race, certain culture, certain ethnicity, certain religions. Now, if we look about, if we look across this as a, from an intersectionality perspective, we do see that it becomes even more difficult for a woman with a certain racial identity, for a woman with a certain religious identity, with a woman with a certain ethnic identity. Now, it's difficult for women across the board, but it's more difficult for a Muslim woman wearing a hijab to be appointed as a woman arbitrator. So that's the truth over here. It's even more difficult for an African woman who is a Muslim wearing a hijab to be represented on the arbitral tribunal. So the problem just gets multiplied when we include other sections, when we include more factors into this. So, but where does it start? We have to first look at this issue of underrepresentation of women. And once we solve this, we can look about the other intersectionalities of race, linguistics, ethnicity, culture, tradition, etc., religion, etc., right? So on and so forth, and even talking about the representation of LGBTQ society at the international commercial arbitration field, right? So many such intersectionalities will be a topic of discussion once we solve this problem of underrepresentation of women, once we come to realize this problem and start to work towards it. So it just starts with the first step. So as we say, one step at a time. So yeah, that's all that I had to share from my side regarding this topic. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you so much. I think it was a wonderful, wonderful session of how you went about, you know, explaining from the genesis of the problem to, you know, what we can maybe expect in future and what is causing all this, basically. So, you know, you very beautifully told that, you know, it is the orthodox mentality of not just in India, but across the globe that, you know, women face this problem. But do you think, like, whose mindset are we to change here? I mean, it is one step at a time, but whose mindset are we to change first for, you know, bringing about a change at all?
So yeah, that's an excellent question, and thank you so much for that. So it starts with changing the mindset of the client. Maybe that's where I would want to start, because those are the people who will appoint the arbitrators. Now, how do we change the mindset of clients? I just scores us back to the underrepresentation of women in the managerial post in top companies. And those are the people who will be the clients, who will be the representatives of the company, who will be the clients actually. So it you know, goes back in a circle, but yes, exactly. It starts there. It starts with changing the mindset of the client. Now it will take a lot of time for having women as representatives of these big companies, but then how can we get an instant solution? We can convince clients to take appointments consider appointing women arbitrators, consider researching more about the arbitrators. If they start to research and not just get inclined towards selecting an arbitrator who is very famous or has a huge record of a reappointment, if they research a bit, if they want to research a bit, then they'll come to know that there are great women who can serve as excellent arbitrators. Right. So yeah, it starts with changing your mind.
Before I go ahead with my next question, I'd also like to request the attendees here to post any questions or, you know, to raise their hand for any questions that they may have. from Sanya. So everybody, please feel free to do that. And also, so do you think this has to do something with work-life balance also? Because see, in India, I know you specifically told that it definitely has to do something with that. But in India, there's lesser work-life balance as compared to many other countries. There is more also. But in a lot, there is lesser work-life balance in India than other countries. So do you think that is also one of the reasons why Indian women specifically face this issue as compared to, you know, women across the globe?
Absolutely, absolutely, yes. So we see lesser women of Indian origin, not just in the international commercial arbitration, but even in the domestic field. Even in the domestic arbitration, we see more Indian men being involved in the field. It definitely has to do with the cultural and traditional beliefs. Now, as I also stated, that lesser women in India tend to complete their studies, and let's just not even talk about completing their higher educations, specifically in a non-arts field, right? We tend to think of women to be someone who will go and choose English literature, maybe, well, maximum become a doctor. But being a woman in the field of business, a CEO, that's something even parents will say, no, why are you even going ahead with this? You know, you just have to go ahead and take care of your families. Why not just take a less expensive course and get a flexible career, right? So yeah,
but I think arbitration is, I don't think it is way more flexible than traditional litigation, and I think women can actually be an asset in the arbitration field because of the flexibility of the whole procedure itself. It's something that you can schedule. It's not a lot. It is definitely running around, but it is a planned running around, maybe. Because a lot of people associate then women with this particular fact also, that, you know, maybe they cannot run around as much as, you know, a man can. So I think that also makes a whole lot of a difference as to, you know, that in that entire aspect or mindset of, you know, being able to run around and do a particular job. For example, you know, it's a very, in traditional litigations, we have clerks in every chamber, we have clerks. But till date, being 3 years into practice myself, I've never seen a woman clerk do that. That's really shocking, because that's something, you know, first year of, that is a very important job. It's not, I think it goes hand in hand with being a lawyer. If you don't know how to do that, how are you supposed to run a chamber tomorrow? So, and women don't do that. Women aren't, maybe they do not have the mindset to be doing that, or, you know, they've never seen women do that. Like, I would never want to become that, because I've never seen women, you know, be in that field or do that. But I think it all narrows down ki bhai, you know, tomorrow when you actually get into the field, you have to learn that particular thing, but there's no opportunity. So I think, yeah, that is one bit also with something that came to my mind. So there's somebody, I think Ankita, who's posted something. So I'll just read it out. Ma'am, speaking of mindset, how does one interested in this field work around worried parents who want to see their daughter settled in life, but at the same time expect her to join a stable 9-to-5 desk job?
Something that I also had to think about before choosing a career in academia. So the problem with 9-to-5 desk job is something that we might not face in the international commercial arbitration specifically, because we have to travel a lot. Now, it's international. We'll have the seat of arbitration in many countries. We'll have to work with different time zones, right? Yeah. So we'll have clients from different countries. We'll have to work around the time zones. We'll have to constantly be logged into our emails. We'll have to constantly be logged into our Teams app or whatever app you have for connecting with your clients. And you'll have to be on your toes. You'll have to be on your toes, on your laptop all the time. Time zone, travel, everything is a problem over here. So that's something that's even more difficult in the international commercial arbitration. Now, and even as Ankita asked that, how does one interested in the field work around their worried parents who want to see their daughters settle in their life? Now, see, this whole problem with India is we as daughters, even we tend to incline towards a more flexible job or maybe a more a settled job in which we don't have to travel, right? Even if we see women in the field of military or women in the field of administrative services which oppose this issue of this challenge of transfer, lesser women tend to go towards that, and we want to stay as close as we can with our family. So worried parents, yeah, you know, I can't even tell how to work around with convincing our worried parents. But no, this is a tricky question. Not just tricky. This is a question that I myself have not been able to answer, to be honest. That's exactly why I'm in the field of academia.
I think just tell them that, you know, the perks of being an international arbitrator or even an advocate representing a client in an international commercial arbitration. I think perks are innumerable. So I think it is a choice mostly. And if it comes to explaining to your parents, I think it's mostly about telling them the perks of the same. There is good remuneration. There is planned this thing. There's feasibility of, scheduling your own arbitration rather than, you know, having a tariq pe tariq in litigation. So that is definitely lots of perks. So I think that is one way to go about it, definitely.
But the problem here is whether or not our parents will be convinced with the perks.
Yeah, that's up to your lawyer skills, I think. How much convincing power you have.
So exactly. And then also the whole point of scheduling is it's more upon the clients as to how many arbitration nominations we get, right? It's at the hands of the client, so it's very vulnerable. We don't know if even if we go ahead in the field, we'll be with work or be without work. We'll be just end up being listed as an arbitrator, or we'll actually be someone who will be nominated as an arbitrator.
Yeah, to be doing the work, actually. Being listed is another thing, but another to be thing. Able to do that is, and that is, I think, where that TP pipeline, you know, exactly. You know, arises. I think that is the stage where, you know, we lose out on women in these.
Yeah,
because
they don't tend to move ahead with the career because they're not getting a kickstart in their career, and they tend to shift or overall leave the career.
Exactly. So I think that's it. Do you think but we should have institutions, arbitration institutions should have a mandate for appointment of you did talk about the pledge that's been taken, but hasn't really, the numbers haven't really changed through the years, but do you think we can maybe have a mandate in institutions like SIAC or DIAC in India, these institutions that, you know, you ought to keep these many women on a tribunal or have to have these many nominated? Do you think that that will help, or that is something that, we as women or we as women arbitrators in future, put this forward and, get this done?
Of course, you know, but that might face a bit of backlash by the men again, because then even the clients will say that now we are bound to have a woman. Now we don't have a choice. And arbitration, this whole thing revolves around the choice of the parties. Now they'll be like, no, this is just against our choice, the basic tenet of the of arbitration, and you can't just bind us on having a woman arbitrator just because you are an institution who is overlooking our arbitration. So that might have a backlash, but we can find a way of getting through this. We can have the websites of the arbitration being more open and being more I might say elaborate in this regard, as to which do not just reflect the CV, but they also reflect the areas of expertise, etc. Or maybe have a different section of listing the women arbitrators so that people can see that, okay, so these are the women arbitrators. Let's just see what do they have to offer us. Yeah. Exactly. So these women arbitrators just get mixed up in the name list, and we don't even sometimes know that this is a woman arbitrator. We can have a different list maybe that will make it more elaborate and more clear.
Definitely. I think you beautifully answered the question by telling its pros and cons.
Yeah.
So I think very well done there. So I think it's also with the trust that clients, they would definitely want to see somebody like them across the table. So I think men also have this, or, you know, businesses maybe have a problem in putting their trust on a woman. Maybe. I mean, that could also, I mean, what do you say about that?
Yeah, exactly.
No, I mean, please go ahead.
Yeah, exactly. So when I was talking about the intersectionality of ethics and arbitration and talking about impartiality, so this bias that we have in mind against women, it generally works very badly for us, and men tend to think that maybe she'll get partial, or maybe it's easy to, you know, give her some perks and bribe her, or maybe just convince her. Well, that is not true. Every arbitrator across the board maintains impartiality, and if they don't, be it a man or be it a woman, they'll face the repercussions. But it's just a psychological bias that men tend to have against women, specifically if the parties involved have some traditional views, for example, a party from Middle East. You'll see these biases being the main factor governing the appointment of arbitrator as well. So yes, definitely.
So you gave a lot of statistics on, you know, through the years, how women have been appointed and how we see an underrepresentation. So do you think this underrepresentation is faced by men with different ethnicity or religion? It's a thing, it's a problem in, you know, representation of men with a diverse religion, etc.
So I would agree partially, because then we have these regional arbitration centers. And for example, if it's a regional arbitration center in Latin America, then the people who will see being appointed as arbitrators most will be Latin American men, right? We know that this arbitration is something that's seated mostly in London, and it's a thing of Europe. So we have more white men across the board, but we do have a good representation of colored men as well. But yes, that's definitely a factor that you said, that it's something that's dominated by white men, or European men when it comes to men. But it's not as difficult for them as it is for women, because the hurdles that women have to face take example of a woman of color with a specific religion and a specific ethnicity as well. Now the hurdles that she'll have to face are more than the man than the man will face. She'll have to face the hurdle of being a woman first, her identity which she cannot change. Now she'll have to face the hurdle of ethnicity, then the hurdle of religion, and then maybe race as well. So four hurdles. Now for men it's a bit easier, because in their own region they'll be preferred, but in their own region itself, for example, talk of a woman in Latin America itself, the Latin American men will be preferred over the women just because of the first attribute that she has, that of being a woman. So it's a bit more difficult for women, and I agree that it's difficult for men as well when we include other factors, but it just works worse for women because of the factor of intersectionality.
Definitely. So we are beyond our time. I can maybe get on or send you an email of my questions, or maybe we can get on a discussion. I think there's one last comment or suggestion that a student would want. Ankita again, she's saying, I'm a law graduate keenly interested in pursuing a career in this field. Can I share my CV for your evaluation and guidance as to get started or right direction to go in to establish myself in commercial arbitration?
Ankita, surely you can send me a request on LinkedIn as well. I do have some samples for CV as well, templates for CV, so I can share them with you, have a look at your CV, guide you as per my ability, if that helps you. And yes, I'll be more than happy to help. You can send me an email as well. I'll just type out my email address as well, so that just in the chat box.
Yes, and I'll just, I mean, as soon as Sanya's done doing that, I will read it out for the other YouTube watchers also.
Yeah.
So we've very nicely covered the genesis of this underrepresentation problem, concept of this leaky pipeline, at which stage women, you know, tend to fall out of this system. The choices, you know, of women becomes quite limited, you know, because of other factors involved, and not just in India. Now we know that it's a problem not just in India that is faced, it is a problem that is faced across the globe. And what all biases are there in the field, and what are the different factors for the same, and steps that are, you know, being taken for actually solving this problem, as you said about the ERA pledge. And thank you so much for actually discussing this issue, because I think this is one of the first times or nascent stages that this topic is actually coming up for discussion also. So thank you so much, Sanya, for, you know, discussing this on our platform today. I'd request everybody to, you know, please rate the webinar from 1 to 10, you know, 10 being the highest, 1 being the lowest. And thank you so much, Sanya. Any parting words that you would like to say to our, you know, attendees, students and watchers, please, any last notes? Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. And I do see in the chat box someone requested for the presentation slide. So I'll email that to you or send it to you across WhatsApp so that you can share it across with the participants if they want. So if that might be of any help. And yeah, thank you so much for giving me this platform. And I really hope that we have more discussions in this regard. We have more female arbitrators or people who want a career in this field to speak up against. You know, speak up in this field and in this upon this topic, and we really need more discussion. You know, it starts with speaking up, starts with letting people know that this is a problem, right?
Yeah, definitely. Just a minute.
I gave out my email address. If you could just read it out to them or send them across in the WhatsApp. Yeah.
It is kishwarj650@gmail.com. kishwarj650@gmail.com. I am sending it again to all our attendees here. And with that, we end this session. Thank you so much, everybody, for attending. Thank you so much, Sanya, for such lovely words and you know, such a detailed explanation of this entire issue. And with that, thank you, everybody. Thank you. See you. Bye-bye.
Take care. Thank you.
Thank you, Sanya. Thank you so much.